even perspective is a mathematical analog that you can develop. And if you have the raw analog about how things change relative to a fixed point, which is what perspective is a predictive index for, you can manipulate that. So these pictures tend to be very subtle manipulations of things that are totally within the realm of possibility.
From March 17th to April 8th, 2009, my friend Scott Noel had a show at the Gross McLeave Gallery in Philadelphia. In case you didn't make it, I'm going to start this film by quickly jogging through the show with my Canon camcorder and ASICS running shoes. This is a terrible way to view Scott's work, which is all about nuances of color and paint application, but at least you will get a sense of how good his paintings are. In addition to being a remarkably gifted visual artist, Scott has thought long and hard about the nature of art, history, aesthetics, and time, and can articulate his ideas with a breathtaking clarity. Not that I entirely agree with him, but boy oh boy, does he make you think. Some of the figure paintings in the show have titles referring to myths and ancient history. It is these paintings and the insinuation of story into seemingly straightforward portrait-like images that really captured my attention. This one is entitled Medea, which is the name of a famous play by Euripides. I was a bit foggy in my knowledge of this play, but Scott explained it to me and some Penn students who were also at the gallery.
You know, I'm talking about Medea, the comic that dresses up in drag and plays the mother from hell. That's based on Medea. Did any of you guys know who Medea was?
Another was entitled Octavia and Antonia Divide the Empire. And Scott explained in riveting detail the disposition of the Roman Empire after the murder of Julius Caesar. Both these paintings have an undeniable force and presence, but is that because of the mythological underpinnings or in spite of them? And just exactly how did Scott work out these ideas in the painting process? When I went home, I whipped out my copy of Euripides and mulled over the story.
You guys know who Medea was? Medea is the subject of a tragedy by Euripides. She was the wife of Jason. Jason the Argonauts. And Medea was the daughter of a king in Colchis. She was half god. One of her parents was a god. She was also a sorceress. Jason makes an alliance with this beautiful woman to help him liberate the Golden Fleece from Colchis. But what happened after Medea and Jason succeeded in their theft of the fleece? They go back to Jason's home city of Argos, and they have a couple kids. Things haven't changed all that much. After a few years and a couple of kids, Jason decides he's tired. Well, be careful. She's, you know, not to be trifled with. But starts dallying around with a local beauty and threatening to trade Medea in. Medea knows exactly how to take revenge. You know what she did? She killed her kids.
Oh.
The day I went over to film Scott at Gross McLeaf, many prominent Philadelphia artists also showed up.
There was Deirdre Murphy, a fine painter and a professor at the University of Pennsylvania, who brought her class over.
Would you guys mind if you ended up on YouTube?
Mine.
What's that?
They love it.
Oh, good. All right. Now, can you all take your clothes off?
Right. And a little while later, the wonderful landscape painter Jeffrey Reed brought a class from the Community College of Philadelphia. And finally, Jeffrey Carr, the dean of the Pennsylvania Academy of the Fine Arts, showed up with a ravishingly beautiful young woman in tow. When Scott had talked about the lust of Jason, my blood got stirred up, and I asked Dean Carr a totally inappropriate question.
And I'm going to ask a question that will now make sure that I never get a teaching job at the Pennsylvania Academy.
Yeah.
Are you a daughter or a trophy wife?
She's my trophy.
Oh, you are a wife?
I'm a daughter.
Oh, thank God.
Scott explained that the stories in these paintings slowly evolved over time and that the compositions were not pre-planned.
Little by little, I started rummaging through my amateur interest in history and mythology, and I started seeing it.
The Octavia and Antonia painting began as this one figure, and slowly objects and even the second figure was added as ideas came to him. The reason Scott's mythologically based paintings sort of troubled me at first was because it seemed impossible for a viewer to understand the allusions just from looking at the paintings. On the other hand, I realized that many paintings are like this. And for the great ones, the exact nature of the story doesn't matter. You don't need to be a Christian to appreciate the human drama in a Flemish crucifixion. You can have empathy for the depressed-looking woman in Scott's Medea, even if you don't know the story. I favorably compare his painting of Octavia and Antonia to the two ambassadors of Holbein. And also to the Sacred and Profane Love by Titian. You don't need to know the rather complicated philosophical backstories of those images either to derive great pleasure from them. I called Scott up to ask him explicitly about all of this. Here's what he told me. What is essential to the paintings is not the narrative. It's the erotic charge, the contrast and negotiation between two very distinctive physical presences that I am trying to express.
This is a painting about two powerful people who are kind of like generals in drag, you know, conducting some sort of negotiation. You don't know what it is. But little by little, in my painter's mind, little stuff starts to form. This really raw sensuality that Michelle has, and this slightly sort of more buttoned up, held in quality that Kali has, just really looks good together. It's really interesting.
Awesome.